So today, we start with the fourth chapter from your text, Hornbill, titled Landscape of the Soul by Natalie Trovoroff. Now, what this chapter basically is about, it is a comparison between two cultures, between the Chinese and the Western culture in respect to arts, all right? Not performing arts, but visual arts, basically doing with painting and sculpting. Difference is Western arts and Chinese art. That is being explained in this chapter, and it is a very easy chapter to begin with. So we start with the fourth chapter, text Hornbill, titled Landscape of the Soul, page number 34, all right? A wonderful old tale is about the painter Wu Daozi, who lived in the 8th century. His past painting was a landscape commissioned by the Tang Emperor Xuanzong to decorate a palace wall. So this chapter begins with a story, all right? A painter named Wu Daozi, who was commissioned by an emperor named Emperor Xuanzong, commissioned to paint the palace wall. The master had hidden his work behind a screen, so only the emperor would see it. For a long time, the emperor admired the wonderful sea, discovering forests, high mountains, waterfalls, clouds floating in an immense sky, men on hilly paths, birds in flight. "Look, sire," said the painter. "In this cave at the foot of the mountain dwells a spirit." The painter clapped his hand and the entrance to the cave opened. "The inside is splendid, beyond anything words can convey. Please let me show your majesty the way." The painter entered the cave, but the entrance closed behind him. And before the astonished emperor could move or utter a word, the painting had vanished from the wall. Not a trace of Wu Daozi's brush was left, and the artist was never seen again in this world. So something unnatural occurred, all right, when Wu Daozi was commissioned to paint the palace wall. He made a beautiful painting, and he finally called the emperor to look at it. It had trees, it had birds, it had mountains, it had people climbing the hills. At the base of the mountain, there was a cave, all right? And then Wu Daozi, he called the emperor and he said, "Look, sire, inside this cave, there are beautiful things. Let me show you." He clapped his hands and suddenly the cave opened, all right? They're looking at a painting and yet the cave opened. And the painter said, "Let me show you." And he went inside the cave. It is a painting, all right? And yet, the painter Wu Daozi went inside the cave, and before the emperor could say anything, the cave closed again, and the painting itself disappeared. And there onwards, nobody ever heard of the painter Wu Daozi ever again, right? So it was something supernatural. A cave in the painting opened, the painter went inside the cave, and the painting disappeared. Right in front of the emperor. Such stories played an important part in China's classical education. So these are stories from China's classical education. The books of Confucius and Zhuangzi are full of them. They help the master to guide his disciple in the right direction. Beyond the anecdote, they are deeply revealing of the spirit in which art was considered. Contrast this story or another famous one about a painter who wouldn't draw an eye of a dragon he had painted for fear it would fly out of the painting, with an old story from a native Flanders that I find most representative of Western painting. So, one story has been shared with us about the painter Wu Daozi, and the narrator who is telling us the story says that Chinese classical art is full of such stories. There was another painter who refused to draw the eyes of the dragon that he had painted. All right, he completed the entire dragon, but he didn't paint the eyes. Why? Because he was afraid as soon as he will paint the eyes, the dragon will fly away. That was his belief, so he never finished the dragon. So now he says, this is what Chinese artists composed of. All right, it is composed of something that are beyond one's understanding. Like the first story, ki bhitre nahi painter goya, and the painting disappear. You cannot find the explanation for such things. Right? The painter says that if I finish the dragon and I finish the eye of the dragon will fly off. You cannot explain that. Now that is West Chinese art. Now the narrator tells us an example of Western art through a story. In 15th century Antwerp, a master blacksmith called Quentin Metsi fell in love with a painter's daughter. The father would not accept his son-in-law in such a profession. So Quentin sneaked into the painter's studio and painted a fly to his latest panel with such delicate realism that the master tried to swat it away before he realized what had happened. Quentin was immediately admitted to be apprenticed to his studio. He married his beloved and went on to become one of the most famous painters of his age. So as compared to Chinese art, now Western art, it is story. In 15th century Antwerp, there was Quentin, a man who was a blacksmith. You know who a blacksmith was, right? They work with metal. He fell in love with a famous painter's daughter. But the painter didn't want Quentin to marry his daughter because he's just a blacksmith. All right, and painting is a noble profession. So he thought. So what did, what is his name? Quentin do? The girl that he loved, his father had painted a very nice painting. He sneaked into the art studio and he painted a fly on the painting. Are you painting a painting machine or a jinga mate banaya? Simple. But it looked so real that the painter tried to kill it again and again when he later saw the fly. And when he realized what had happened, then he understood that Quentin is a gifted artist. And he took it as his apprentice. Who is an apprentice? Apprentice is someone who is a student, let's say. Chela Banjani. That is apprentice. So now the painter got him married to his daughter. Now why this story? Agari Chinese kore your story bane. Now you will know. These two stories illustrate what each form is trying to achieve. A perfect illusionistic likeness in Europe, the essence of inner life and spirit in Asia. So in Western culture, it is more about realism. Like the fly that was created. It looked so real that the painter tried to swat away the fly. But in Chinese art or Asian art, it is more about inner life and spirit, which goes beyond your understanding, all right? It talks about inner life, inner peace, and about your spirit. Whereas Western art talks about being real. What is real? And in Chinese art, it is more about imagination. It is more about how you feel. So this is the basic difference between the two kind of arts. In the Chinese story, the emperor commissions a painting and appreciates its outer appearance. But the artist reveals to him the true meaning of his work. The emperor may rule over the territory he has conquered, but only the artist knows the way within. Let me show the way, the Tao. A word that means both the path of the method and the mysterious works of the universe. The painting's gone, but the artist has reached his goal beyond any material appearance. So in the Chinese art, while the emperor, Chinese art is only for the people who understand its meaning, basically. The emperor was looking at the painting of Wu Daozi. He was appreciating the painting, right? The trees, the mountains, the people walking, the birds flying. But then he did not understand the essence of the painting, which the painter was trying to show. That is why he had told the emperor, let me show you the way, all right? And then he goes inside the painting, signifying that he understands the painting, what it is about, what is the essence of the painting. But the king could not follow him because he is only looking at the outer beauty. He only sees the colors and the trees and the mountains, but he feels to understand the spirit of the painting. That is why he is unable to follow the painter who disappears inside the painting. A classical Chinese landscape is not meant to reproduce an actual view, as would a Western figurative painting. Whereas the European painter wants you to borrow his eyes and look at the particular landscape exactly as he saw it from a specific angle, the Chinese painter does not choose a single viewpoint. His landscape is not a real one. You can enter it from any point, then travel in it. The artist creates a path for your eyes to travel up and down and back again in a leisurely movement. This is even more true in the case of the horizontal scroll, in which the action of slowly opening one section of the, painting, then rolling it up to move to the other adds a dimension of time which is unknown in any other form of painting. It also requires the active participation of the viewer who decides at what place he will travel through the painting, a participation which is physical as well as mental. The Chinese painter does not want you to borrow his eyes. He wants you to enter his mind. The landscape is an inner one, a spiritual and conceptual space. So one other prime example that they show is, they say that this is a Western painting. All right, let's say the artist has drawn an apple. You just look at the apple. All right, okay, this is an apple, that's it. You are looking at what the artist is trying to present it to you. All right, eura image ma dekhako cha from one angle. And that is it. But when it comes to Chinese artists, they present it in a way so that you can have multiple angles to view it. They even talk about a scroll painting. All right, now scroll, what is a scroll? You've seen in movies, right? When they send messages, it used to come like rolled up like this, and they open it and then read, right? So that is the scroll, and they present, let's say this is a scroll and this is the painting, and I am looking at the painting and I'm still unrolling it, right? So I can decide to roll it all the way and start from the other end. I can start from this end, and it has multiple images going on. As you open the scroll, jati scroll kholde gayo, you'll see more and more of the painting, all right? And you can decide where you want to stop. If there's a hill and there's a valley, you can say, okay, I don't want to look at the hill, I'll look at the valley. Let me travel in the valley, let me see the details. So that is the option, or rather, that is how a Chinese painter wants you to study their painting. They don't want you to just look at what he has painted. They want you to enter his mind and understand what message he is trying to convey. Whereas in Western paintings, it is more about lightness, realism. If they draw a mountain, they'll draw a mountain as it looks. If you draw clouds, they'll draw clouds as it is, as you look, and when you see in the sky, you see clouds. That is exactly what will be represented. But in Western, in Asian painting or Chinese painting, you will see that mountains are being depicted in a different way. The clouds are being depicted as circles. So that is how the artist wants you to view at it. They want you to understand it. They want you to enter the picture. They don't want you to just appreciate the outside beauty of it or the realism of it. They want to hit your essence and your inner spirit with the painting, all right? So we stop here and we will continue.